Good evening. Welcome to First Evangelical Lutheran Church here in Midtown Houston. I'm Evan McClanahan. I'm the pastor of this wonderful congregation, and I'll also serve as the moderator and timekeeper for our debate tonight. Before we begin, yesterday I'm sure we all saw the news of violence in the name of religion in Paris, and it just made me thankful that we can come together in this nation and in this place and have a civil discourse on topics like this. So never want to take that for granted. At least I assume we'll be civil tonight. We'll have to see how the evening plays out. But.
Without further ado, on the question, does the soul exist, I'd like to ask Eric Hernandez, our affirmative speaker, to begin with his 15-minute presentation.
Good evening. First, I'd like to thank you all for being here, for Pastor Evan for putting this together, and for Matt's willingness to be here. Let me first start by giving you two things this debate is not. This is not a scientific question. In fact, science in principle cannot even answer the question, much less ask it. Some of the leading neuroscientists in the world believe in the soul, such as Jeffrey Schwartz and Mario Beauregard, and you can't say that it's because they don't understand the neuroscience when these are some of the very leaders in neuroscience. That is because the question for tonight is a philosophical question about metaphysics and not science. As atheist philosopher of science Michael Ruse says, science does not ask certain questions, so it is to no surprise that it does not give certain answers. So appealing to science to answer the question tonight is like appealing to a ruler to measure your weight. It's simply the wrong tool for this assessment. Second, belief in the soul is strictly speaking not a Christian belief. Many of the arguments I'll be using for my view tonight are espoused or came from atheists and non-believers such as John Sorrow and Frank Jackson. Now, I'll be arguing two basic points tonight. One, that consciousness is not physical. And two, I am more than my brain and body. I am a soul. So let's start by giving some definitions. I hold the view known as substance dualism, the view that I am a soul that has and interacts with a body. What is a soul? The soul is an immaterial thing that contains consciousness, animates the body, grounds and unifies my experiences, indivisibility, personhood, identity through change, and free will. Now let's talk about consciousness. Now, consciousness is defined ostensibly, meaning you point to it, so you point to instances of it. For example, how do I define the color purple? By pointing to instances of purple. So describing purple to someone who was born blind would do no good because they would still not know what it is like to have a direct experience of purple. Which was actually a version of an argument used by Frank Jackson, who, mind you, is not a believer. Now, the five states of consciousness, and there are five, is thoughts, beliefs, desires, sensations, and acts of will. With this in mind, let's look at arguments that support the first point, that consciousness is not physical. First is the argument from identity. Now, we know that conscious states, such as a sensation of pain, is correlated with certain brain states, like C fibers firing in my brain. We know there's a correlation. But I want to make one thing clear. And that's just because we know the correlations, it does not mean that the two are the same thing. For example, fire causes smoke, but no one would say that fire is the same thing as smoke. So in my view, correlations are actually expected, seeing how there is a soul that is deeply integrated with a body. But as atheist philosopher Thomas Nagel would say, correlations are not explanations. They are, in fact, the very thing that need explaining. So how do we know that conscious states and brain states, although they are correlated, are the same thing? Well, simple. Because there are things true of my conscious states that are not true of my brain states. Take beliefs, for example. A belief could be true or false, but it makes no sense to say that a region of my brain is true or false. For example, no one's going to look at a brain firing and say, look how true that brain firing is. Similarly, my brain can weigh 3 pounds, but it makes no sense to ask how many pounds does a thought of this debate weigh. While Matt and I may be having heavy thoughts,
We don't need to wear neck braces. Second is that, so consciousness, being immaterial, is not contained in the brain. It is contained in the soul that is correlated with my brain. Two, consciousness is irreducible. For 50 years, one of the leading intellectuals in the world has been atheist philosopher Thomas Nagel. A few years ago, Nagel published a book entitled Mind and Cosmos, Why the Materialist Neo-Darwinian Conception of Nature is Almost Certainly False. His fundamental argument in the book, Thomas Nagel being an atheist, is that you can't get mind from matter. Atheist philosopher Colin McGinn says that any naturalistic explanation for this borders on sheer magic. As a metaphor, he uses Jesus turning water into wine, and he says, how did evolution convert the water of biological tissue into the wine of consciousness? Now, here's the problem in detail. Things like watches are what you would call mereological aggregates, meaning it's a collection of separable parts, and all of its functioning could be explained by looking at the levers, the gears, and so forth. And not once in describing it would you have to appeal to things like brain conscious states, such as thoughts, feelings, hopes, desires, and so forth. In other words, aggregates like watches can't have these things. Well, the fact of the matter is, the brain is not a substantial whole in itself. It too is an aggregate, meaning it's a collection of billions of parts put together. Well, what's the problem? Take beliefs. When you look at the base parts of the brain, go to the fundamental base parts, you get things like electrons and quarks. Well, the problem is that a single quark cannot contain a belief. And it's not like when you put a lot more together or you rearrange them, you fix the problem. It's not like at 9,999 neurons, there are no beliefs. But when you add one more, boom, you've got beliefs. Why not? Well, because if a single quark cannot contain things like beliefs, then putting more together and rearranging them does not give you beliefs. And it's not that we can't see how it happens, and I'm not saying that science doesn't yet know how it happens. That would be to miss the point. Rather, it is that trying to understand how it could happen would be like trying to understand what it would be like for the color blue to weigh 5 pounds. This is simply a category fallacy. So the point is, no matter how many quarks or neurons you add, or how you rearrange them, or what structure you give them, it'll never give you beliefs any more than rearranging the furniture of my house will give you the color blue. Third, conscious states have intentionality, meaning beliefs are about things. Take my belief that 7 is a prime number. The belief is about the number 7. So again, the problem is that by simply rearranging neurons in a different group or structure will not make them about the number 7. Now let me pause just for a second. People usually misunderstand the argument, and what they usually object is they say, but you're just committing the fallacy of composition. And here's what they mean by that. One red brick weighs 1 pound, then a whole house of red bricks will weigh 1 pound. But that's not at all analogous to what I'm saying. What I'm saying is more like this. Say there is a whole house of red bricks, and in the end you will still get a red house. And simply rearranging the bricks into a different pattern or structure will never give you a different color. So rearranging my neurons won't give you beliefs any more than rearranging a red brick house will give it the color blue. Fourth, consciousness is a unity. Similarly, we know that when a person looks at an object like a table, the brain doesn't treat the awareness of a table as a unity. This is because different regions of the brain process different aspects of the object. And there is no region of the brain that puts the object back together into a unified whole. Now, why is that? Well, because for this, you need something that grounds all of your experiences into one single substantial subject that owns these experiences in order to have a unified visual field. Philosopher Eric Lacroix, gives the example of 5 chefs in 5 separate kitchens, and each of these 5 chefs is only working on one part of a single recipe. Now, even if all 5 chefs were working on the recipe at the same time, it does not follow that there is any one single chef working on the whole recipe. In a syllogistic format, it goes as follows. One, I am either an aggregate, a collection of parts, or a soul. Two, aggregates cannot have a unified visual field. Three, I do have a unified visual field. Four, therefore I am not an aggregate, I am a soul. Now let's look at my second point. I am more than a brain and body, I am a soul. The first argument is the indivisibility of personhood. One, a physical object can be divided and come in percentages or degrees. Two, I cannot be divided, I am an all or nothing kind of thing. Three, therefore I am not a purely physical object, I am a soul. Let me illustrate. If I were to take this table and cut it in half, I would get 50% of a table. But the same cannot be said of a person, because personhood is an all or nothing kind of thing. You can't be divided. Numbers, for example, are the exact same way with respect to being even. The number 6 is not more even than the number 2. Evenness is not a property that comes in degrees. It either is or it isn't. Now, it's true that some operations have been done where they've actually removed 55% of a person's brain, or Dandy Walker syndrome, where a person is only born with 10% of a brain. Now, the point is, you don't have 90% of a person after this. You still have a full person. They may lose functioning, but they do not lose personhood. So since I cannot be divided, but my brain and body can, it follows that I am more than my brain and body, I am a soul. The second argument, identity through change. If something is a physical object composed of parts, it does not survive over time as the same object if it comes to have different parts. My body and brain are constantly changing, losing, and gaining new parts. Three, if I am to survive over time, I must be more than my brain and body. Four, I do survive over time. Conclusion, therefore, I am not my brain and body, I am a soul. Let me illustrate again. If you could take me apart piece by piece, there is nothing you can point to and say, oh look, there he is. Because I am not identical to any part of my body, neither am I merely the whole of my body. For example, if you could take a car apart and replace every single piece, you'll end up with a different car. And then if you take those replaced parts and put those back together, you'll now have two different cars. But the same cannot be said of me. Here's why. Say I committed a crime 10 years ago, but the evidence just now came in. Well, according to science, we know that we get, every 7 to 10 years, we get new brains and bodies, or at least for sure new bodies. Well, if I were merely my brain and body, I would just have to say, excuse me, officer, that wasn't me, that was some other guy, go find him. But good luck, because he doesn't exist. But that's absurd. Why? Because we know that persons retain identity through change and part replacement. Therefore, it follows that since my brain and body are constantly replacing parts, I am not my brain and body, I am a soul. Three, the argument from free will. One, I am either a soul or a physical object. Two, if I am a purely physical object, then I do not have free will. Four, but I do have free will. I freely came to this debate tonight. Four, therefore I am not a purely physical object, I am a soul. Aristotle used this illustration. He said, if I move a rock with my staff, then my hand moved the staff, my staff moved the rock, but what moved me? Now, if you want to say that it was a brain firing that caused my hand to move, to cause the staff to move, to cause the rock to move, I would simply have to ask, and what made that brain firing fire? And sure, you could say the same thing, but then we'd end up in an infinite regress and the action would never be accomplished. So here's the point. For there to even be free will, you need a personal free agent that is capable of being the originator of all your actions. But if there is no soul, and all you are is a purely physical machine, then you don't have free will. I don't put a dollar into a Coke machine and it chooses to sing me a song instead of give me a Coke. So if you deny the soul, then you have no grounds for believing in free will, which literally means, and here's the punchline, that every thought you've ever had was not your own. So literally, the last thing you can call yourself tonight is a free thinker. So in conclusion, we have seen at least 7 independent arguments for the existence of the soul. The first argument was the argument from identity, which shows brain states and conscious states aren't the same thing. the irreducibility of consciousness. Third, conscious states have intentionality. Rearranging neurons don't make them about things. Four, the unified visual field. Five, the indivisibility of personhood. Six, personal identity through change. And seven, the argument from free will that I have free will and physical objects do not. Thus, we have good evidence for embracing substance dualism. If Matt wants us to believe otherwise, then he must first provide a case for his own, and in his rebuttal period, give me valid, sound reasons why he rejects my position, and until he does that, the rational person is well within his rights in embracing the existence of the soul. Thank you.
All right, thanks everybody for coming. I appreciate the invite. And on the subject of donations, before I get started, in addition to you may not want to donate to a church, they paid me, so it would be a good idea to donate. So I remember a story when I was a kid of a relative whose grandmother had died, and she went to bed shortly after the funeral or sometime after she died. And in the middle of the night, she had what she thinks is a visitation from her dead grandmother. And she woke up a little while later and found a, grandmother butt-shaped dent in the sheets. And so her conclusion was that this really actually happened. It was enough for her to believe in a soul, in an afterlife, in all of the things that she had been taught. But there were other people in the family who disagreed on various points. Some believed that this was a dream, and maybe it was a dream that God sent, you know, to comfort her, that there wasn't actually a visitation. Others said it couldn't possibly be a visitation from her grandmother because souls go to heaven and that's where they stay, because God's not the author of confusion. He wouldn't confuse people by sending ghosts around. And souls don't have mass to disrupt the bed, so clearly that was another miracle from God, or coincidence. And all these explanations were based on biases and rationalizations. They were looking for an explanation that was sufficient to explain their observations, but they didn't really care whether or not it was necessary. Anytime you come up with something as a proposed explanation for an observation, in order to say that this is the case, you need to demonstrate that it is both sufficient and necessary. And so when we talk about why is there something rather than nothing, well, the gods that may have been invented to serve as explanations for those, of course they're going to be sufficient causes. They were manufactured to be sufficient, but there's no demonstration of necessity. And similarly, we can say the same thing about many of the ideas to souls. Now, we can't disprove the story. I can't prove to you that she didn't see her grandmother. I can't prove that she did. And so the only thing that I can say is I believe that she had an experience. I'm just not convinced that her interpretation and the conclusions that she reached about it are correct. What if we had hundreds or thousands of those stories? And we do. Would that be enough? These anecdotal accounts that we can't investigate and we can't confirm, appeals to causes that are sufficient, but with no demonstration that they must be the case, that they are the cause to the exclusion of other possibilities. No amount of anecdotal evidence is ever going to be sufficient to justify something that there's no observation of. An accumulation of that sort of evidence is neat, but we have that in many other areas where we don't generally agree. There's lots of alien abduction stories, ghost stories, and other things where many people have similar stories and they've come to similar conclusions, but we tend to not believe, despite the garbage that you see on the History Channel. It's natural that our ancient ancestors would have come up with the idea of a soul. It makes perfect sense, especially in light of limited information. I'm standing here having a conversation with you and you drop over dead. Nothing that I can see has changed about your physical state. So it's natural to conclude that something that was there is gone and that this something must be invisible and perhaps intangible and that it moved on. Whether or not it continues to exist, we don't know, but that's the way you can come to a belief that a soul exists. It's not a stupid belief by any means. It's hung on for a long time. Even when I think, and I've said before, that the idea of a soul is the most dead concept in all of theology. The soul's attributes, Eric already listed a bunch of them, personality, memory, desire, animative control of the body, communication, compassion. Essentially, it's the proposed immaterial mind that inhabits and controls our body, the ghost in the machine. And it leads to beliefs, or is part of beliefs tied to those, about afterlives and reincarnation and ghosts. And humanity is completely inconsistent about what it believes with respect to the soul. It believes in a soul, but not necessarily reincarnation. Some do, some don't. It believes in a soul, but not necessarily ghosts roaming around or visiting people. Some do, some don't. It's hard to get a clear definition of what the soul is, other than we need a label for all of these things that we don't have an explanation for, these things that make us us. It seems that each individual accepts the portions of the soul claim that fit with either the religion that they're in, the religion they were raised with, or what their personal beliefs have come, with no offer of solid evidence for the claim. Now, when I talk, I do a lot of debates about, you know, does God exist? And people get frustrated because I defend kind of a weak atheist position or an agnostic position, because the burden of proof is on people claiming that a God exists. And the answer is either I believe it or I don't believe it. That's it. And I'm arguing typically that there's not good reason to believe it. When it comes to a soul, not only do I think that there's not a good reason to believe it, I think we're starting to learn more to the point where there's good reasons to believe that it's probably not true. If you go on Google and do a search for, and you probably won't be able to spell it, but some of you could, V.S. Ramachandran is a neuroscientist, and if you do a search for V.S. Ramachandran split brain, you'll find an interesting conversation that he had at the Beyond Belief conference in 2006. Split brain patients are those who have the corpus callosum severed so that the two hemispheres of the brain can't communicate with each other. And in one of the studies, in one of the cases where he did this, essentially what happens, despite assertions to the contrary, is you end up with two people. Two distinct personalities that identify individually and communicate independently, who can have knowledge that the other half of the brain does not have. The right hemisphere can't talk, but it can communicate using the left arm because the right hemisphere controls the left side of the body. The left hemisphere can talk because that's where the vocal centers are at. And so you're able to actually communicate independently. We can also do with the eye swatch. There's great studies on this where somebody is shown two pictures while they're staring at a central dot, and one side of the brain knows one picture and the other side of the brain knows another, and we can test this because of what they draw versus what they say. It's amazing. This should have, to paraphrase Ramachandran, this should have thrown shockwaves through theology and philosophy, but as I think we'll find out a little later, it's difficult to shock them when they try to claim that this isn't a scientific issue. So there's lots of studies on these split brain patients that have produced all kinds of interesting results. The two halves work independently, can be given information independently. Literally one half knows things the other one doesn't. And you can watch videos, the studies of these patients, and you can read the scientific research, and we don't know everything about the mind. Some might say we know barely anything about the mind, but we do know enough about some things. There were studies where a man would attack his wife with one arm while defending her with another. In another study, a split-brain patient would put a cigarette in their mouth with one hand and the other one would grab it and throw away. And in the study that Ramachandran cited, one half of the brain identified as a theist and the other half of the brain identified as an atheist. That's weird. So this idea that there are disembodied brains that survive our death is strange. And those, I find no supporting evidence for it, which is why we end up going into philosophical arguments about free will and irreducibility, or irreducible reductions to infinity. But we can investigate the claims of manifesting phenomena within reality, but not supernatural causes or explanations. So, because I don't think that was really clear, if somebody claims that this phenomenon that we observe is caused by something supernatural, science can't investigate the cause until you give us a mechanism by which we can investigate the supernatural. But it can investigate the manifestation. And this is what we must be talking about in all cases, are manifestations in reality. And if there's a soul that pilots a ship, a brain, that's a manifestation. It's giving it's giving instructions, it's doing things, and so we can observe those things and find out. And what we find is that all of the attributes that are attributed to a soul, apart from its ability to leave the body and go somewhere else, are identifiable as functions in the brain, and we can study people with damaged brains to find out how and when and perhaps why these things go wrong. Alzheimer's patients who lose their memory, I'm sure we'll touch on that a little bit later, it's tragic. There are good arguments to be made that that's not even the same person. But you don't have to go to those common patients. You can go to the really brain damaged individuals whose personalities have been entirely reset, whose memories have been entirely reset. All of their wants and desires have been reset. Now, what happens in that scenario? If there's a soul in my body and I suffer great brain damage to the point where I have a different personality, I don't have my memories, I have different wants and desires, what now is the relationship between the brain and the soul? Surely the soul's not damaged too. But now there's a soul that's a godless heathen and a body that may not want to be. So can I save that soul by this body's actions? Can I compile more sin onto that soul? None of this makes any sense. And what it also shows is if there's a soul that's somehow not able to communicate through my brain, but I'm able to walk and talk and interact and make decisions, then clearly the soul is not required for any of that, which absolutely rebuts the claim that the physical cannot produce these sorts of things. We hear about near-death experiences and other claims. I don't know if we'll go into any of those tonight. But quite often, what we're left with is anecdotes about, well, if there's no soul, then how can you explain X? Which is an argument from ignorance. Maybe the answer is, we can't explain X. Or maybe it's, we can't explain it now. But if you accept a proposed explanation, you've stopped all research towards what could be the correct explanation. So what happens when we die? It's a mystery, with countless attempts by religions to answer this. And none of them have any explanation because their answers don't have any explanatory power. They're attempting to solve a mystery by appealing to a bigger mystery. What is it that makes me move? Oh, it's a soul. What's that? It's the thing that makes you move. What is it that gives me this desire? What is it that makes me think this or like this? Oh, that's your soul. How does it do that? What's the soul? Oh, the soul is the thing that does these things. It's an explanation. It's a fiction that we seem to have invented to explain things that we don't have a good understanding for. Does the soul exist? Not as far as we can tell. There's no good reason to think souls exist and considerable reason to think they don't. The difference here is that the people who in many cases are advocating for a soul are saying the physical cannot produce this. It cannot possibly serve as an explanation for this. And as Erica said earlier, which I probably should save for rebuttal, this isn't a scientific question. But what science is saying is not, there is no supernatural. That's not a declaration of science. Science doesn't say, there's no supernatural realm. Stop, you're all stupid. That's not what science says. Science says, we're not able to investigate the supernatural realm if it exists, so we're stuck dealing with the natural world. And we can make all sorts of philosophical arguments and tie ourselves in knots, but the reality is, I have a brain, which we could cut open my head and examine, presumably, unless I'm some freak. And we can identify the parts of my brain that do certain things, and while we don't understand everything about it, we can tweak things and we can examine damaged brains, and what we discover is that everything that's been attributed to the soul, your personality, your memories, these are all things that are actually malleable and functions of the brain. Consciousness is a big mystery. Daniel Dennett wrote a book called Consciousness Explained, and the critics said Consciousness Explained Away was the criticism they gave of his book. But the fact that we don't necessarily have a good answer or an answer that appeals to everybody doesn't mean that we should just accept an answer that's coming from philosophical realms and theological realms. It is a scientific question. If there's a soul that interacts in any way with reality, then by definition, that interaction is detectable and identifiable. And from what I can see, all we've done is take these things that we don't understand, lump them into a little ball and say, yep, this is what we're going to call the soul. We've mislabeled things throughout our entire history. I think it's best understood as a misexplanation. Because we're weird. Consciousness is weird. We're strange beings. We seem like we have free will, whether we do or not, which is another argument and point of contention among philosophers. I seem to be this thing. I feel like I live somewhere in my head, looking out through my eyes, experiencing things that way, and that's the way it feels. And so the best description I can come up for that, since it clearly can't just be my brain, well, why not? How have you shown that it cannot possibly be just a brain when all of the evidence points to the fact that it is? Damaged brains act differently. When a brain ceases to function, so does everything that we identify as a soul, which is why the explanation for the soul has it magically departing the body then. Because now there's nothing left to examine. This is noisy.
Now, it seems all Matt did was point out some interesting phenomena and give us correlations. But you'll recall that in my opening, I already addressed that correlations are not explanations, but are in fact the very thing that need explaining, which Matt failed to do. So let's explain these phenomena and correlations in light of my view, given substance dualism. First, you have things like what he actually mentioned. You have better explanatory power on substance dualism with things like personal identity. In my arguments, I claim that if there is no soul, then sameness through change is impossible. Well, it seems that Matt actually agrees with me on this point based on his view of identity, where he says that things like brain trauma and these kind of experiments give you different persons. But clearly this is absurd because it leads to things like this. Say a guy's having problems with his wife, and the next day, unfortunately, she gets in a tragic car accident, and it alters all her memory traits and personality. Well, if what Matt is saying is true, then this guy's now single because his wife no longer exists. Married men, don't get any ideas, and ladies, stay away from people who think this way because this is a false view of identity. B, it explains interdependence. The leading expert in the world, his name is Stanley Klein, who is a non-believer, said it is ridiculous to think that memories are in the brain. He says they have to be in the soul. He says the brain is like a CD. And when it has grooves in it, and when placed in the right retrieval system, you'll get your music. However, if the CD is broken or scratched, much like if I have a defective brain with Alzheimer's, then you won't have access to the music. But clearly, a broken CD doesn't mean broken music, and it doesn't mean that new songs emerge.
See,
change presupposes sameness. When an apple goes from sweet to sour, it underwent change, and its properties, but clearly it's the same apple. That is because for there to be real change, there has to be something that underlines that change and remains the same through the entire process. So a person who undergoes a traumatic event doesn't become a new person, but merely loses aspects about themselves that they once had. Otherwise, on Matt's view, you get people popping in and out of existence. Two, you have better predictability. A, you would expect functional dependence, which he gave us a lot of good examples of. When I play guitar and a string pops, I lose guitar functioning, even if I'm the world's best guitarist. Similarly, if you mess with my brain or damage it, I will lose bodily functioning. But this does nothing to prove that there is no soul any more than a pop guitar string proves that there are no guitarists. B, you would expect two-way causation. As philosopher John Searle said, consciousness has a real effect in the world. If there is a soul, then we would expect to see causal power over the brain and body. Now this brings us into the fields of neuroplasticity and cognitive behavior therapy. Jeffrey Schwartz, who is a leading neuroscientist, has done tremendous work for patients with mental disorders such as OCD, anxiety, and depression. He specializes in what is called cognitive behavioral therapy. Now, what this means is that you can literally change your brain chemistry simply by changing the way you think. As Dr. Kurt Thompson puts it, nothing in the brain changes without neurons changing. So, if I want to engage in a new discipline and fix bad habits, that would require the redirection of my neurons, and by simply thinking differently, I am able to cause that redirection of my neurons to undergo a new functional connection in my brain that was not there before. This is called neuroplasticity. And this is all possible only if, as Jeffrey Schwartz put it in his book title, you are not your brain. Now for the naturalist, an alternative to dualism is what is called physicalism, which is a view it seems that Matt seems to be espousing. However, he hasn't expressed which of the five types of physicalism that he holds to, which is a rather odd thing to leave out in a public debate. Nonetheless, physicalism is roughly the view that consciousness, whatever it is merely a physical function owned by the brain and body. So let me just mention two things that follow from this view that is known to every naturalist, regardless of which of the five they take. First of all, if physicalism is true, then, and this is actually David Hume's position, there is no enduring I or self. According to physicalism, much like a baseball game, you don't move through time, rather you're just a collection of time slices. For example, in baseball, the first inning is not in the ninth inning, and when the first inning is over, it ceases to exist, and the next inning comes to be. So under this view, A, you don't exist from one moment to the next. B, there is no enduring self who was, is, and will be the owner of all your experiences, fully present at each moment of time. However, if you are the same person that walked into this debate tonight, then physicalism is false. So if physicalism were true, there is no free will. Take neuroplasticity, for example, which we just talked about. It would be obvious that it would require you to go have the ability to go against your habitual way of thinking. This is known as libertarian free will. However, on the physicalist view, A, your thoughts and actions are determined by your inputs and outputs, and there is no room for freedom of the will. However, and if you chose to freely believe in physicalism, then physicalism is false. Now, based on 1 and 2, if physicalism is true, we have a new conclusion. And that's 3, that rationality is impossible, and here's why. Say right now you're undecided as to which position in tonight's debate is true. Well, at least 2 things are needed for rationality. 1, you need to be the same self, fully present, at the beginning, middle, and end of tonight's debate. And 2, you must be free to think about the arguments, weigh out the evidence, and then freely come to a conclusion. Now, based on this, in summation, if at the end of the night, someone tries to come up to you and tell you that they have freely and rationally came to the conclusion that physicalism is true based on the evidence and argument that Matt presented, then ironically, that alone would prove that physicalism is false. Thank you.
There's a lot of stuff that we got to. I'm not going to do an entire debate on free will, other than to point out that there are a lot of people who don't think we have it, and even some of the people who do definitely don't think that we have libertarian free will. Maybe we can have some questions about that. But he's pointed out that I failed to offer an explanation for these observations that he explains by appealing to the soul. And I don't think that's completely true, because as I pointed out, there may not be an explanation yet. Saying you have an explanation and that your explanation stands until somebody can give a better one doesn't make your explanation true
or rational, not remotely. He said that the science that demonstrated that there were 2 people there, functioning independently with different likes and preferences, one of them a theist, one of them an atheist, was absurd. And yet he appeals to all sorts of experts.
But the big question was, if you're the same person that walked into this debate, then physicalism is false. And I would argue that what we're really talking about over and over again is a matter of identity. And there's a lot of really good examples. He used one about a car. And the problem is the labels that we put on things is how we identify them. But we're not necessarily good at doing that. I would argue that you're not the same person that walked into the debate tonight. As a matter of fact, I would argue that whether physicalism is true or not, it is absolutely impossible that you are the same person who walked in, because you've had experiences here that you didn't have before. Set aside whether or not how many atoms have changed in your body or anything else, you have clearly had some experience that has changed you. Now, whether or not it changed the soul, I can't say. because I don't know anything about a soul. I don't have any way of investigating it, but your brains are different. Now, how much different? I don't know. It may vary between you. So, the assertion that the physical cannot prove this is something that Eric's made. And I don't know how you can demonstrate, because you're basically making a universal declaration that it is impossible for the physical to produce this. And that's what the entire foundation of his objections are. The physical world cannot produce this. Look at the assertions that showed up at almost the top of each slide. It was just a bald assertion. Physicalism can't do this. How do you know? How did you demonstrate that this is impossible? This is why so many people try to avoid an actual scientific discussion about this and go to a philosophical discussion, because philosophically, as much as I'm a philosophical nerd, you can prove almost anything. And if your only requirement is that your explanation be sufficient, congratulations. Universe creating pixies created the universe. It's sufficient. Brain creating pixies created brains, and they did so in a way so that it can produce all of these effects that you're identifying as a soul, and they specifically told me this is what they did. So we can appeal to divine revelation as well, or pixie revelation if you want. The example about a bunch of red bricks, you can't rearrange them, you still end up with a red house. This type of problem here is, first of all, red bricks are red. You're only looking at one facet of it. Neurons are not like that. You mentioned neuroplasticity. We understand that the brain is not like a red brick, that neurons don't just produce neuronic or neuron thoughts and thoughts about neurons. Consciousness, one of the most common explanations for it, is that it's an emergent property of the brain, much that wetness is an emergent property of water. A single molecule of water isn't wet. But as you get more and more molecules, and I don't know how many, you produce this quality of wetness, which doesn't exist in any single molecule. That emergent property is how the consciousness has often been explained as a product of the brain. But even if it's wrong, that doesn't mean there's a soul. Can't divide a person, 50% of a person. Well, I think we dealt a little bit with dividing it. I would say that each of the personalities left in those split brain patients are whole persons, because person can't be quantified. But you're not the same person. You don't have the same thoughts, the same interests. This labeling of identity, oh, you're not the same, you change all the time. Yes, and so does the label. So there's this problem of, how do I know I wasn't abducted last night and that I'm actually a clone that aliens left? I don't. I can't prove it, I was asleep. Maybe we could have had a camera up, whatever, maybe they found a way to foil it. But this, whether it's me or a car, where we're constantly replacing parts, every time we replace a part, it's not the same car. If we're looking back at the original, but that's not the way we do things. Because the label isn't this specific car, it's my car. And if I replace the muffler, it stays my car. And if it gets a dent in it, it stays my car. Until I sell it. These are labels that we imbue things with. And my identity of who I am, I'm a different person than I was many years ago. I did things that I probably could have gone to jail for. And to use a part of his example, if they came up to me now, I would have no defense, because the way society views me is, you are the bag of meat that did this crime, and that's the only way we can practically label you, because we can't get into your head to find out if you're a different person than you were before. We can try to assess it, but the fact is, I'm absolutely a different person than I was then. There's no way I could do those things, at least not in the same way, for the same reasons that I did them before. The label Matt Dillahunty has been applied to this physical body for 46 years, give or take. And it changes. We don't bother to change it every single second. Because every second, every moment, I'm getting a new memory of what I just said and what the reaction was and whether or not this person smiled, whether or not this person frowned, or whether they're playing with their hair or staring off in space. All this information fundamentally changes my brain. But it remains my brain, because we're the ones doing the labeling. Appealing to some sort of transcendent, static labeling of everything is absurd when you live in a demonstrably dynamic universe.
We're moving to the cross-examination portion of this of the evening. And so the way this will work is Eric again will go first, and Matt will go next, second. Be 10 minutes each, and each will have two opportunities to ask questions. And without further ado, let's begin the cross-examination. Eric, go ahead.
All right. Let's start with the most important and crucial question that is really that would actually give this debate a point. And that would be, libertarian free will, as I said, is the ability to will or refrain from willing to do something. So, do you believe free will exists?
I don't believe libertarian free will exists. I'm a compatibilist, and a la Dan Dennett, but I think libertarian free will doesn't exist.
And did you freely come to believe that?
Under the compatibilist version of free will, I may or may not have. It appears that I was able to assess things as a thinking agent, and that's good enough. What Dennett basically argues for is the varieties of free will worth wanting. I have the freest will I can imagine. Libertarian free will tends to go further, implying that the decider essentially is not bound by constraints.
Let me press you a different way then, if I can.
Sure.
According to compatibilism, it simply means that you have the freedom to freely choose what you were already determined to do, at least according to compatibilism. For example, let's say a mad scientist, for whatever reason, has put some kind of electrode in my arm to make me punch the person in front of me. Now, I may actually want to punch whatever person that's in front of me.
Sure.
So even though I did it, I still could not have refrained from doing it. So even on compatibilism, there is still no free will that is at least necessary to make this debate meaningful.
Well, so on compatibilism, my best example of how compatibilists view free will, or at least I do, I can't speak for all of them, or maybe I can, is it's about recognizing a difference between two things. For example, you could get up and walk out the door right now. Or somebody could pick you up and drag you out the door. There's a difference between those two scenarios, and whether or not you have libertarian free will isn't even relevant to those. Compatibilism is just identifying that there's a difference between actions taken by this thinking agent and actions unduly influenced or directed by another thing.
I disagree. According to compatibilism, you are already determined to do something, but you can't will to do anything else. And that's the very point of free will. It's called dual ability. You have to be able to either at least will to do it or refrain from willing. So, for example, even if someone did drag me out, I could still will to not be dragged out. So libertarian freedom, or any kind of freedom, all differ on the point, do you have the ability to at least refrain from willing or willing? So let me just ask it again then. Do you think that everybody here could have not come to this debate tonight without anything else being different?
Without anything else being different?
Right.
Absolutely not, under libertarian free will or anything else. If nothing else was different, then whether they willed it or not, they were going to come.
So they were determined to come here?
If everything was the same, sure.
Okay, what you just said is something you were determined to say. You couldn't have said otherwise or even believed otherwise, which means you have no way to prove whether your beliefs are true or false, because no matter what, you're determined to believe them. You would admit that.
I have plenty of ways to prove whether or not my beliefs are consistent with reality, which is the only thing that matters.
Well, not if you're determined. You have to believe it. You have no choice.
Whether or not I chose to believe it or not is independent from whether my beliefs are accurate, just as you being forced to punch somebody is independent from your will. My belief could be true whether I was destined to believe it or whether I willingly believed it.
But again, you're assuming my position, and now you're thinking that you could see if it's true freely and that you're not determined to believe whether it's true or not. In other words, you have to.
No, I'm saying that I believe X is independent from whether or not X is true.
Right, sure.
So it doesn't matter whether I was determined to believe X or whether I willingly opted to believe X. That is a separate issue from whether or not my belief is true.
So what you're admitting exactly what I'm trying to say is that you're going to believe something whether it's true or not.
I'm going to believe whatever I believe. That's the way it works. You don't choose your beliefs. Beliefs are not an act of volition.
Right, and we can get to that later. Let me ask a different question. Are you responsible for the beliefs that you hold?
Yes.
So then you freely chose to believe it. You weren't determined to.
I'm responsible in the sense that we hold me responsible. This is the way we operate. I don't know, you might have been talking about a different responsibility, but...
In other words, do you think, well, then we go in a circle, so let me just try it again. Can I ever act contrary to my desires?
Can you ever act contrary to your desires? No.
And did you really desire to say that, or were you just determined to say that?
I don't know that I felt a desire, but I certainly didn't act in contradiction to a desire.
Right, and I don't want to keep going in a circle. My point is, and I think you actually agree with me here, is that no matter what, this debate would technically be pointless, because no matter what either you or I say, everybody here was determined to be here, and whatever we say, they're going to believe regardless of what we say because of prior actions that happened.
No, where do you get regardless? Even if it's all determined, maybe they will change their mind. It's determined that they will change their mind based on what I said or based on what you said.
But that's not what
There's
I said.
There's nothing about free will that says you get to ignore every action. It's the actions that matter. It's the interactions that, if anything dictates what you believe or what you accept, it is the interactions.
But that is completely irrelevant. So what I'm saying is that in order for them to make a free decision, they can't be determined. Because, for example,
I'm not convinced they made a free decision. I came here to debate the soul, not free will.
Well, the soul has to do with free will. If there's no soul, there's no
free
will.
But I don't believe there's a soul. And simply asserting that we do have free will doesn't still get you to a soul, because there's no demonstration that even if we have free will, that this means there's a soul.
Let's try a demonstration. If you're here today and you don't believe in free will, could you please freely raise your hand?
Oh, you do.
If you noticed the way I worded that, I don't think you caught that. I said, if you don't believe in free will, please freely raise your hand. And some people actually did that. That alone would prove that at least that there's some type of free will. Nothing determined them.
No, it wouldn't.
How would it not? So
that's stimulus response. You haven't demonstrated that it was free will.
How did I not? I said, if you freely believe to raise your hand, how is that? So they were determined to
say that. I could program a computer to respond to, if you freely believe you have free will, turn the screen white, and tell a computer that, and it would do that. It doesn't demonstrate it had free will.
But now you're begging the question. You're actually giving me an example where there is no free will. And that's the very question
I don't know that there's not free will there yet. I'm just saying that this particular example demonstrates the problem with your example. You're assuming that a response to an action necessarily means there's free will, and I just gave you a counterexample that doesn't require free will, which is a defeater for your example.
Because that counterexample begs the question. That's the very thing that we're trying to ask. Well, okay.
No, it doesn't beg the question. It's a counterexample. It's saying this doesn't have free will and could still do what you just said was required free will. If you say, response requires free will, and I show you an example where that response doesn't require free will, that's not question begging, it's pointing out how you're wrong.
No, not at all, because...
It's his question, sorry.
Okay, well, let's talk about others, because first of all, I don't agree with you. If I freely choose to raise my hand...
How'd you know that you did? Oh, sorry, your questions.
Okay, no problem. Now, let's talk about desires. I can go against my desires because I can have every desire in the world to want to lose weight and get in better shape, and I have a desire to eat a cookie, but I can choose to refrain from that. Secondly, if I have conflicting desires, it is literally up to me to which desire I choose. You know, a lot of people wake up in the morning, you got to go to the bathroom, but you don't want to get out of bed. You have to choose between one of those two conflicting desires. So, and what I said earlier, if there is no free will, and even if determinism is true, what you're saying is I was caused by prior events to do something, and I could not have done otherwise, then we cannot have rationality. This debate is completely pointless, and no matter what we say, everybody is determined to believe a certain thing.
And I would say that the opposite's true. Your position is that you can violate the causal explanation. You can violate causality. You can willingly violate causality, and that puts an end to rationality. It is, in a dynamic universe, it is causality that gets us to rationality, not violations of causality.
Well, no, not at all, because I can refrain, like I said, from willing, and that's and it just seems that we disagree, so I'll have to move on. But again, we have 1 minute left, so let's just finish that up. If there is no, like, for example, if I have an itch, I can resist a scratch.
Yes.
Well, that's free will.
So you said, can you ever act in violation of your desires? And the complexity here is that there are some desires.
Can I resist my desires?
Can you resist your desires?
Right.
There are some desires that are in conflict.
Sure.
Okay? You can resist scratching to satisfy this desire if there's another desire that you value higher or that is higher valued, whether you are free of will or not.
Well, I value eating cookies more than I value losing weight, but I can still refrain from eating a cookie.
Yeah, because you value losing weight more than
you're assuming that, but you said you can't look at my brain, so how would you know?
So there's two reasons. Well, all right, there could be more than two reasons why you would choose losing weight over eating a cookie. One of them could be that you value losing weight more at that particular time, and the other one is that you can violate the causality of the universe and freely choose to deny will. Why would you do that if you didn't value losing weight more? So it's self-defeating.
Well, that's question begging, but time's up.
A reducto ad absurdum is not question begging, but so I apologize in advance, although we went from a soul to free will, so I don't think this is much of a stretch. Did God create the universe?
I believe so.
Okay. Did he have a choice in what kind of universe he created?
Yes.
Did he know what was going to happen?
Sure.
So God knowingly created the universe in which mm-hmm. I'm an atheist and you're a Christian.
Right.
Then you don't have free will of any sort.
You're assuming God made you an atheist. We're going back to assuming there's no free will.
God could have picked a universe in which I remained a Christian, right?
I don't know.
You said he could have created a different universe.
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming among those different ones there are one where somebody, two universes God could have created, somebody ends up going to hell, and in another universe he could have created, they ended up going to heaven.
I have no idea. I'm not God.
Okay. I wasn't expecting you to be God. I was just, you know, for the sake of...
Well, I would have to know what God knows. Well, let me put it to you like this, because essentially you're asking about fatalism, all right? That if God knows the future, it's the old question about foreknowledge. If God
knows
the future...
It's not just about knowing the future. It's about specifically creating this world from other options. What you're saying, you're essentially avoiding this. So...
No, I was about to give you an answer.
So let me just clarify, and then you can address it.
Okay.
Here's God. I'm God, and I can create two different universes.
Sure.
And they may be different.
Okay.
Either it's the case that I create in this universe, Matt is an atheist who ends up going to hell or whatever
sure.
he does, and in this universe, Matt's a Christian. Either those are two. Or in both of those universes, in all possible universes God create,
right.
I end up as an atheist.
Right.
In which case... We're back to whether or not there's any difference in the universe
no.
of God could create.
Okay, now we're talking about what you call counterfactual statements. So let's say, hypothetically, here's a counterfactual statement. If Eric is rich, then he would buy a Mercedes. If Eric is not rich, then he would buy the car that I have outside. Well, I'm not rich, so I have the car that I have outside. But if I were rich, I would have done this. So a counterfactual doesn't show that there's no free will. If anything, it shows the opposite. It shows if this... than that, but in the end, they are still my free choice.
Did God create the universe knowing whether or not you'd be rich?
Sure, but what does his knowledge have to do with my free will?
Because if he chose to create this universe as opposed to another one that gave you different opportunities...
No, okay, again, you're begging the question. You're assuming there is no free will. If there's free will, regardless of what universe God created, it is still up to me to do whatever it is in whichever universe I find myself.
I'm only pointing out that under one particular God model, which you may not adhere to, there definitely is no free will. And that is the God model, where God created everything, could have created it differently,
right,
and chose to create it this way, knowing what would happen.
Right. Okay.
There is no free will in that universe.
Let me, if there was only one door to go out of today, it would not follow that I am forced to go out of that door. I can not go out of any door. So, again, you're begging the question that just because there's one door, the universe that we're talking about, then I have to walk through that door.
No, God knows whether you're going out the door or not.
And what?
Right?
Again, yeah, sure.
So if God knows you're going out the door, is there anything you can do to not go out the door?
Yeah, he only knows
you
because of what I'm going to do.
You can do something to get God wrong?
Which is what I'm trying to go to. Okay, let me tell you exactly what I was saying in the beginning. You're asking about fatalism, which is what I was about to address.
Okay.
Say at my daughter's next birthday party, I record everything. And then the next day I talked to someone who wasn't able to go, and I said, well, let me show you the video. Now, I know infallibly what happened on the video, but at the timing of that video being recorded, everything was done freely.
Yep.
Now, me knowing and the video already having what happened does not in any way insinuate that what happened in the video was determined to happen and could not have done otherwise, just
yeah,
because I know
you didn't
it.
Create the circumstances of that video. This is where the analogy fails with God.
You're arguing the analogy, not the point. Again, if I know what happens in the video, it doesn't mean that the video is determined to happen. While I recorded it, it was freely done. You're familiar with Craig. He gives the example of the infallible barometer, where he says, say you have a barometer that knows the weather tomorrow. Well, the barometer doesn't make the weather happen. It predicts it, what's going to happen. And, of course, if it's infallible in God's omniscience, then it can't be wrong. Now, if the weather were different tomorrow, then the barometer's prediction would have been different. But whatever the weather is tomorrow is what makes the barometer, gives it the prediction that it is. So God knows what I'm going to do tomorrow, but that doesn't cause my actions.
I didn't say that.
That's
Once
what you
again,
want? Okay.
No.
Clarify, please.
I specifically went to three prongs, which I'm going to move on after this, that there was a creation, knowing what would happen, and with the opportunity to create a different universe with a different outcome.
Right.
Your example of the videotape is you're watching it from outside. This is the common response that God is outside of space and time, sees it like a videotape, sees it.
Well, I don't
it,
think God's outside of time, but...
Okay. Watching a videotape is outside of the timeline of the events that took place. A videotape's never going to change,
right?
And you can know what happens. The difference
sure.
between you filming something and you intentionally creating all of the circumstances within the tape, that's the difference between the video example and God.
You're assuming there's no free will. If I could... When I proposed to my wife,
I
said everything
assuming,
up. She still could have said no.
I'm not assuming there's no free will. I'm pointing out one type of free will that is in conflict with one notion about God. What would it take to change your mind about the existence of the soul?
Well, first, if you can show me why my seven arguments are wrong and where they're false, which you haven't done. If you could show that... Well, first of all, you got identity over time. If there is no soul, then you don't stay the same. If there's no soul, there's no free will. So technically, there's nothing that could change anybody's mind about the existence of the soul. There are things that physical stuff can't explain. See, earlier you talked about science answering the question, but that scientism is a well-refuted view of knowledge. I mean, there's a lot of things science can't prove. There's a lot of things science assumes. You can't prove scientifically the existence of truth because, first of all, science presupposes truth before using it.
Science doesn't make proclamations about truth. It doesn't presuppose truth. Science doesn't tell you what's true.
Right, because it's not a scientific question. That's a philosophical
Correct.
Question about epistemology. That's
and
exactly
maybe,
my
and
point.
And maybe, philosophically speaking, maybe... There is no truth. Maybe
is that
truth
true?
Is an abstract concept that we've invented to label things. What science tells you are what are probabilistically the most reliable models of the reality we experience.
You're familiar with self-defeating statements. You said maybe there is no truth, but you assume that's true. You say truth
no,
is
I didn't.
Just...
What is the problem with the word maybe that you say I'm making an assumption?
Well, even if you said maybe there's no truth, then that might be true, which proves that there might actually be true and that you're...
That's an acknowledgement that I don't necessarily know the answer to this. It's certainly not making an assumption.
I disagree. Agree to disagree.
I didn't make an assumption. I'm saying I don't know. If I say
okay.
I don't know and you're just going to disagree with me, now you're not debating.
No.
You're just being a contrarian.
No, 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 I don't know, because you're the one making the claim that science doesn't give us truth. I say exactly. You're proving my
I'm
point.
Making a claim that what?
Science doesn't give us absolute capital T
that's
truth.
That's not just me making that claim. That's
it doesn't
the
matter
facts about science.
Okay, again, that's my point. This is not a scientific question. You can't use science to answer metaphysical questions.
Sure.
I don't use a ruler to measure my weight. That's just a category fallacy.
I agree with you that it's the wrong tool. The problem is that nobody's given us the right tool. Nobody's demonstrated any tool that can reliably examine or confirm the existence of anything supernatural.
Okay, right. And see, now we're no longer talking about the soul. Now we're talking about the method. I could equally say no one has given us a tool that shows us that we can't have tools to demonstrate this. I mean, then we just go in a circle.
Yeah, the difference is I'm not making an assertion that we can, and you are, which is why you have to demonstrate
okay.
that you have a method that is reliable.
Okay.
Simply saying that nobody's shown us a method that's not reliable doesn't mean that all of a sudden whatever anybody asserts without a method gets to be assumed as rational.
Okay, well, give me another method, please. How would we investigate?
So this is the common thing. Give me another method. How do you explain this if not that? That's an argument from ignorance.
No, your method
stands until somebody else comes up with a better one when you haven't provided any method.
No, I gave seven arguments that included methods.
You gave seven arguments. There's no method to verify that a soul exists.
Seven arguments for the soul. Which
you
one
made
of those
a bunch of
you
assertions that physicalism can't do this with no demonstration
okay.
that it can't.
Well, you're making an assertion that I need a method. What method did you use?
I'm making
that?
An assertion which can be verified by watching the tape back.
Right, and you're asserting that I need a method, but what method did you use to find out that we need methods?
No, I'm not saying that I used a method to determine, although I would say that the method that I used was reason, that we need some way to tell the difference. So I have a t-shirt. I want to believe as many true things and as few false things as possible, which means in order for me to have a model of reality that best matches reality or even super reality, I have to have mechanisms that can be demonstrated to reliably produce useful information that is consistent with the reality I experience.
Well, that leads to an infinite regress. What a lot of people don't realize here, and it's getting more obvious, is that we both differ on our views of truth and reality and knowledge. I take the position that knowledge can start with a belief that you don't have to verify. You take the methodological approach. I mean, you can laugh, but that's not a disagreement. That's just...
I'm sorry. That was actually rude, but I was drinking and
it caught me off guard. So, okay, well, let me on your view, I say, I believe A because of B. And you say, why do you believe B? Because of C. And why? And eventually, when you get to Z, you can't verify that by anything else. But on your view, everything you believe is circular and self-defeating.
There's a problem where people start to point out an infinite reduction, and Carl Sagan had pointed out, you know, if we keep going down this road, we'll never stop asking questions. And Carl Sagan replied with, why stop?
Because we won't know anything. You have to start. Well, you won't know anything if we don't get anywhere.
I'm over.
We're at 10 minutes.
Okay.
Your turn.
Okay.
Well, I want to take a time out. First of all, I'll say... I'd love to do a sequel of this. You guys are a lot of fun. First of all, I see a lot of smiles in the audience, so I think y'all are enjoying it as well. And it's a great conversation, but y'all are free to, you know, sort of ask questions and get answers. But y'all can keep, you know, y'all are conversing freely. I mean, that's the cross examination. But so we'll do one more each, okay? And start thinking about questions. And after these two cross-examinations, we'll turn in the survey and the questions. Go ahead.
Okay, how do you identify a mental state?
Sorry?
How do you identify a mental state?
I don't know what you mean. I'm not trying to be frustrating.
No, it's fine. Well,
there's a number of different ways. You can do an MRI scan to show what the brain state is.
Right, but I'm not asking about the brain state. I'm asking about the mental state.
I don't know what the difference is.
I gave an argument earlier. I said that they have different properties.
I don't think that they do. I'm convinced that the mind is produced by the brain, and I am okay with a reductionist view that we're talking about brain states. It's just that they present in a way that is different, much the same way that with the water wet analogy.
Well, there's a problem with that, but we can get there later.
Yeah, no analogy is perfect.
So you're saying that you take Dennett's view that there is no consciousness, that consciousness is it's not there.
No.
Well, you said you took a reductionist position, so it's just whatever the brain does. So
saying that the mind is something that the brain does, that this is produced, it's a phenomena that's produced by the mind, doesn't in any way deny that we're conscious.
Okay, so you said, you identify a brain state by what kind of pattern it has in the brain. I mean, a mental state, right?
So we correlate with a physical component, and the assertion is not the physical brain is all that there is.
Okay.
The position is the physical brain is all that I can identify, and the assertions that there are more can't be verified.
So in order to know you're in pain, you have to look at your brain. Is that what you're
saying? I know I'm in pain because my brain experiences pain. There are pain receptors in the brain.
But you said you have to look at it in order to know what kind of state you're in.
I don't have to look at it on an MRI.
So you feel it, is what you're saying.
My brain feels it. I am my brain.
Right. So you agree with qualia. And there's what I said earlier. There's a feeling to pain.
So I disagree with the idea of qualia. I'm talking about...
That's exactly what you're describing.
No, it's not. I'm talking about the fact that I experience something. Qualia is the idea that there's something specific about the experience that is... substantive almost in and of itself. And I don't, I'm with Dennett. I don't agree. I think qualia is a mindless concept.
Which is why Dennett doesn't think consciousness exists, but you told me he did.
Dennett's fine with consciousness existing. It was the critics who labeled his book Consciousness Explained Away because he talked about consciousness in ways that demystify it. He would still recognize that we are aware and thinking agents.
And John Searle, who's an atheist, who actually refuted lots of what Dennett said. And in fact, he does. He says, look, Dennett himself says, I'm going to shake your view that you think you know what consciousness is. You think we can believe it. Let me show you how you can't. So he actually does away with it.
Yeah. In arguments are exercises that take place all the time. How about instead of me citing Dennett and you citing Nagel, we just talk about what I believe?
Well, you agree with him, though. That's what I'm asking. And that's the point. I know what he's saying. You haven't really given me too many assertions. So can you tell, let's say you're in a room and... you and another person in the room, and I say, can y'all both point to the red ball? And y'all both point at the red ball. That alone, a behavior and a mental state, wouldn't determine that y'all are actually both seeing the color red. Would you agree with that?
You didn't say anything about red, so I don't know.
I said a red ball.
A red ball.
Right.
Are we actually seeing the color red?
I mean, based on your...
I would say that we have evidence that we are both identifying the same object as a red ball.
Right, but for all you know, he could be seeing blue instead of red. Right.
Well, if you said point to the red ball, and he pointed to that ball, then he doesn't seem to be seeing blue instead of red.
Well, no. In other words, he could have inverted qualia. Like, for example, everybody knows about what color is a dress, right? Everybody was looking at the same dress but saw different colors.
Sure.
So someone could see the same thing and...
Actually, that's not quite true. So I'm not convinced that people saw different colors. People interpreted it as different colors.
Which was seeing a different color.
Is it?
Yeah.
So colorblind people just didn't see?
Now you're begging the question that you need color to see. I never said you need color to see.
You know, offering counterexamples is not begging the question. Begging the question is a specific fallacy to an argument that is circular, that contains its premise at the beginning.
That's like me saying, well, if there's no God, then why does God exist? And that's begging the question. You're saying, well, if you need color to see, then how come blind people see? I never said you need color to see. I'm saying you could see the same thing. And it could be a different color for me than you.
I was pointing out that I think they interpreted the color differently rather than seeing. Seeing is what the eye does, the cones, the rods. It sends a signal to the brain, which is interpreted as different colors, which is why you have optical illusions where you can show something that these two colors are the same, but when you put a bunch of other colors around them, they look very, very different.
But my point is you're still seeing color. Well, if it's in the brain, then you would have to be able to open up your brain and see the color blue or red, but you don't think that the color blue or red is in your brain, do you?
You would have to open your brain to see
it. No, I'm saying you could. If you said that when I see red, you're saying it's in my brain, then
what
I should be able to open my brain and see the color red.
You don't have
red.
To open it. You can put yourself in an MRI. And you can tell
and
when
the color
somebody,
red would show
you
up.
Can tell when somebody is looking at red versus another color.
How? Because you're
because
what you're
certain
implying,
parts of the brains light up for different colors and different experiences.
Okay.
We don't know everything about it. But even if we couldn't do that at all, that doesn't mean that your case is right. But the fact is, we can. We can put somebody in an MRI, we can study their brain states, and correlate them with certain experiences.
And here's the irony in what you're saying. In order to even know what correlations there are, you had to ask the person. Because if it was just a physical thing, like you're asserting, then I could open up anybody's brain and see what they're doing. But the only reason I know what they're doing by correlation is because whoever first did the test had to see what they were doing and say, hey, what are you thinking of? It wasn't by looking at the brain.
You don't have to ask them anything.
Okay.
So you sit somebody down and you put them in
right.
front of a screen.
Right.
And at different time intervals, you flash a specific color and you map what happens on the brain over and over again.
Well, no, that's again, and I know you don't like this, that's begging the question because you're assuming that what they're seeing, the color they're seeing, is the same color you're seeing.
I'm not assuming that at all.
My point is that just because someone has a certain function and behavior and a certain brain pattern is not sufficient to determine what conscious state that I'm in. On your view, you're asserting as long as they do the same function and the same pattern, it's not true. John Searle, he gave the Chinese room argument. He said, if I were in a room and someone passed in, let's say I'm in a room, I don't know a lick of Chinese, and I have this rule book that says when someone passes in this squiggle squaggle, send out this note that says squaggly squiggly. Well, the person on the outside might think when I become so good at this that I am fluent in Chinese, but the fact of the matter is, I don't understand a lick of Chinese.
Correct.
So what John Searle, who's an atheist, who disproved this behaviorism theory, said just because you imitate function does not mean you have understanding. What you're saying
Correct.
Is the function proof, well, then you just refuted yourself. Because that's
no,
what you're
I didn't.
Saying.
I'm talking about experience and identifying brain states that correlate with experience. It has nothing to do with the Chinese room or what the person understands.
Yes, it does, because you're saying that if I'm seeing blue and they're seeing blue, then that must be blue. You're assuming that they have the same brain state.
I actually never said that at all.
Okay.
What I said was when you said point to the red ball and two people pointed to the red ball, what can we conclude from that? Two people pointed to the same object and identified it as a red ball.
Right, which says nothing about consciousness. At least
I didn't say it did. You're the one that's on about
something. So what are you saying tonight? We came to debate.
I came to debate whether or not a soul exists, and my contention is that there's been no reliable demonstration that a soul exists. There's been no method shown by which we can verify a soul, and all of the attributes associated with the soul, apart from its ability to leave the body.
No, I never gave any of those arguments. So that wasn't my position.
I know. You asked me what I came here to do. I'm telling you what my arguments are.
That's not an argument. That's attacking an argument I didn't give. That's a straw man. That's a fallacy. You're attacking an argument I didn't give.
I'm a... No, if I'd said that my arguments rebutted yours.
No, I didn't say that.
That would have been a straw man, but I didn't say that. I came here and I presented a case and I talked about the science behind it. That's not a straw man just because I didn't address your points other than I'm convinced that they were founded on assertions.
Right, well, I think we're talking past each other, so let's try to get back on the same page. What I'm saying is that in this debate, your position is that you haven't been convinced that there's a soul.
I haven't been convinced. I don't see any way of being convinced yet. Somebody would need to demonstrate that. And I'm actually convinced that it's unlikely based on what we know about the brain.
And what arguments would you have for that? Because
I'm not going back through what I presented earlier.
Well, you didn't. I already rebutted that in my rebuttal.
You didn't rebut it. I talked about a split brain patient.
Right.
And you just flatly asserted that that can't be two people. You called it absurd. The scientists disagree with you.
And
what we label as a person, individual experiences, information, interactions, that all of the things that we label as a person, apart from the meat sack that they're in.
No, I disagree. Personhood is not a scientific question. To define a person, you don't look at the physics because I can lose functioning and still be a person. So again, you're assuming that it's all physical. You're assuming that we define personhood by scientists when this is not a scientific question. You don't ask a scientist a metaphysical question. These are philosophical questions. Personhood is not defined by what I do or by science.
I'm not talking about personhood. I'm talking about No, I'm not. I'm talking about not a philosophical personhood. I'm talking about how we tend to label individuals.
Which you said we shouldn't label things, though.
I didn't say we shouldn't label things.
What?
I said we're bad at labeling things. We're bad at looking at the scope of things.
Was that a bad label that you just gave then?
It may be. But somebody would actually have to demonstrate that. Right now, I think it's a really good label, because if we're talking about this is an entity, this is a thinking agent, and it is distinct from this other thinking agent because it has different knowledge, different information, different interactions, different desires, right down the line, it's different. I don't see any other way to label this than that these are two distinct individuals communicating and acting independently, despite the fact that they originally were part of one brain.
Which we disagreed on, but okay.
Oh, well, I don't know where I was. Do other animals have souls?
Yes.
Okay. The soul that you believe in,
mm-hmm.
Can it be reincarnated?
I would say on my worldview, no. Is it logically possible in the broad logical sense? Sure, because there's no contradictions in it, but I don't hold that.
So, of all the characteristics of the soul, apart from the tradition of labeling certain things as a soul, how did you identify which characteristics were actually characteristics of the soul?
Well, first of all, now you're not talking about the soul, you're asking about me, which the topic is not, I'm flattered, but the topic is not about how
I'm debating your position, not... You already said you weren't God. I'd debate him if he'd ever show up.
Well, that's completely irrelevant because you're debating me right now. But the point is, the arguments I gave led to the capacities that I mentioned. A soul is a set of ultimate capacities that I have, even if I don't actualize them. When you're asleep, you still have the capacity to speak English, even if you're not speaking English. So a soul is what grounds all your capacities. That was one of the arguments I gave. I gave the argument from identity. It keeps you the same through change. Otherwise, we're not the same person. I gave arguments concerning free will. We already talked about that. We gave arguments on indivisibility of personhood. We talked about the unified visual field. The only reason I can see things as a unity is because I have a soul that grounds and puts it all back together.
You attribute all those things to a soul.
Well, I give arguments for why I attribute that.
I understand that. Let me just get into this question.
Okay.
You attribute all those characteristics to a soul.
Mm-hmm.
Why didn't you attribute it to a couple of different things?
Because it's metaphysically impossible for something like a quark to hold a belief, just like it's impossible for the color blue to have weight.
I don't see how it remotely addressed the question. So there's a number of characteristics of the soul that you attribute to a soul.
What we call capacities, right.
Sure. Why is it that you get to say that these are the characteristics of a soul and not these are the characteristics of two soulish things?
Two soulish things? What do you mean?
It's an arbitrary label. You're saying that all of these things are encompassed in one thing called a soul.
Right.
And I'm asking how you got to conclude that they're all encompassed in this one thing instead of independent
things. So you're essentially asking about the problem of how we know the soul, how do we, the criteria for it. Well, now we're going in a little bit deeper versions of the soul would be something like traducianism or organicism, which is a view that the soul is literally, which I do hold, which is that the soul from the beginning is what drives and gives form to the body. So the reason I have a human body is because my soul is human, and the reason a dog has its body is because it has a dog kind of a soul. Every soul has different capacities, therefore it needs a different kind of body to actualize the functions that are in the soul. So I have the body that I do because of the functions and capacities that I do.
I didn't ask about your body. I asked about how you determined that this was one thing and not several things.
Right, well, which means that if you just need, that if it is a soul that gives you your body formation, then we can safely assume that it is one soul that is doing it. There's no reason to believe in multiple souls.
So if it's a soul that gives your body formation, we can safely assume that that's what it's the one thing.
Right, and until we have evidence
to
the contrary.
So if we begin by believing that there's a single soul, we can rationally conclude
no,
there's
a single
soul.
No, that's not what I said. No, now you're mischaracterizing my argument. If we can have, let's first talk about how do we know something has a soul. And there's two major criteria for that. One is that if there is, well, first of all, I know that I am thinking. You know that you're thinking. I don't know that you're thinking, but I assume you're thinking because the things that I do when I think, you seem to be doing that too. So I attribute my conscious states and say you must have those too. Like when I get stuck with a pin, I say ouch, and when I say ouch and get stuck with a pin, I have a feeling, a qualia of pain that is identified by hurtfulness.
All of those when things I you say, just described are just experiences.
Let me finish here. So when I see that you have that, I assume, well, he must have that too. You must be feeling pain. So if there is behavior that something else has, then I could safely assume that it must be in the same state that I am. That's one. The second criteria is if my... we have to understand the difference between a substance and what I called earlier a mereological aggregate, which means this. If I take a tire off of a car, it's still a tire, which means that the identity of being a tire didn't come from it being on the car. It was a tire with or without the car. So that makes it an aggregate, meaning its identity... It has an identity with or without the whole. Now contrast that with my heart. If I take my heart out, it ceases to function, which gives me evidence that I have a thing that is ontologically prior to the whole, meaning my wholeness, my substance, is what gives my parts identity versus a mere property thing like a table.
I don't see how any of this addresses the issue of how you determined it's instead of several souls, because all you're talking about is experiences and identity.
Well, because then if you would attribute several souls...
Let me ask this. When does a soul enter the body?
My view in conception.
Okay. So sometimes, after conception, it splits into twins.
Right.
Do they each get a half a soul, or do they have...
No, they have their own...
Hang on. I understand.
And it's a great question, because it's one I had before, when I started researching this. Let's go back to what I said. If something is ontologically prior...
I don't want to run through much time. I think you said that they each have their own...
Yes, okay. Yeah, their own.
So sometimes after those twins split, they fuse.
Okay.
What happens then?
I've never heard of any fusing. I don't know of any fusing. If it did, then yeah, one of them would die. Then one of them would really die because one would have to take over, and then you would have an ontological thing taking over the whole substance. So one soul would have to die. It's just like if me and you somehow got merged or our bodies were put together by a mad scientist, one of us would die.
Sure. So the question that I had kind of as a follow-up to this isn't really relevant anymore because it was, how did you determine this? And the answer, as I understand it from the various philosophical dancings, is...
I was not... Now you're just being disingenuous. Philosophical dancing, I'm giving you reasons and arguments to why I believe what I did. You're just laughing at it and hand-waving.
I'm not being slightly disingenuous.
Okay.
I honestly view it as philosophical dancing because what you're basically doing at every single turn is saying that there are qualities
right,
which necessitate this thing that I'm going to call the soul. There's no demonstration there of the reality of it. It could just be that there are qualities which you are labeling as a soul, as a package, and that is completely separate from whether or not there is actually a soul that is an extant thing that transcends the body.
Right, and all you're doing is giving the possibility that I'm wrong, but that's the weakest argument or rebuttal you can give. Just because
it's a strong enough rebuttal up against an unfounded assertion
tell you why that's not a good rebuttal. Because if you're saying it's possible that I could be wrong, then I could equally say, well, it's also possible that I could be wrong about being wrong, which would make me right again, and then we'd go in circles. So
no,
that's
it wouldn't
not
actually make you right.
It
wouldn't actually make you right again. Another possibility doesn't mean it just puts you in the position where you don't know if you're right or wrong, which is exactly what I've been saying the whole time.
So your
you don't have any way to know that you're right.
So your fundamental answer to this question tonight is I don't know.
Exactly.
And what does that contribute to this debate? If there were a voting poll, and
I tell you what
yes
it contributes
no,
to this debate, and since it's my time, I'll go ahead and do
sure.
that. What it contributes to this debate is it gets people to be aware that I don't know is sometimes the best answer and sometimes the correct answer.
Right.
And it pretending that you do know when you don't stops you from finding the right answer. And I'd rather remove the roadblocks. Hang on. No, I'd rather remove the roadblocks, because if it turns out there is a soul, there's nothing preventing us from finding out for good reason.
Right, okay, and here's what, or, which is what I think you're doing, is that you're simply refusing to believe something, not giving me proper rebuttals to what I'm saying, so really you're refusing to believe something based on a commitment to naturalism, physicalism, whatever the case is, and you're simply saying you can possibly be wrong, therefore I can't know. That is our difference in our foundation.
Okay.
No, well, hold on. That is our difference in foundation, is that for me, I can start and say I can know something without knowing how I know. But on your view, you lead to an infinite regress, and you think, how do I know this? Here's how. Well, how do I know that? Well, here's how. And you'll never know anything on your view, because in order to know anything, in order to even doubt anything, you have to at least know something.
I love how you assert that I can't know anything.
No, that's your view.
Know something. I know all kinds of things. And
in fact, have you asked yourself, how do you know?
Yeah.
And when do you ever stop?
I stop at the basic foundation of logic, identity, non-contradiction, and excluded middle, which is a pragmatic thing. When you say it can't be demonstrated. Philosophers are in universal agreement, apart from those who presuppose a God to serve as an explanation, that the foundations of logic, identity, non-contradiction, excluded middle, cannot be confirmed, because you have to assume them to confirm them.
No.
Okay.
Which is my point. Your view of truth is pragmatic, which is you think that there is no literal truth and we can't know it.
I didn't say there is no literal truth.
I know you didn't, and I've read your website. The way you define truth, the way you define logic, is literally arbitrary. So your
it's
very
not
definition
at all
of
arbitrary. Arbitrary means I plucked it out of my butt.
No, it means that you came up with it somehow, but you have no reason to justify it.
I have reason to justify it.
You just said you can't prove logic.
I said you cannot, so I don't think you can be absolutely certain about anything.
Are you absolutely certain?
No. Why would you? Why?
Well, of course.
I'm not absolutely certain.
You just said you can't be absolutely certain about anything. And then
correct. Okay. I'm not absolutely certain about that either.
Which means you could be wrong, and which means I could be right.
I could be wrong. I fully admit I could be wrong. Demonstrate that I'm wrong, and I'll change my mind.
Well, that again, that's...
Okay, okay.
Okay.
Nice one.
You know those scenes in Rocky where like even the bell rings and they just keep going and like they have to like pull the people apart? I feel like that a little bit.
It's good.
Heavyweight match here. It's fun. Okay. Questions, and I'm gonna take the floor and ask a couple of questions. Could we agree? I know it's impossible, but could we agree to a 1-minute answer just to kind of go rapid shot?
I will do my best to give the shortest answer.
Okay. So if you're asked a question, it'll be a 1 minute and then a 30-second rebuttal to the answer, and vice versa.
Sure.
If it's your question, you get 1 minute, 30-second rebuttal, okay? I know there's going to be a lot of questions, so... So, Eric, what are the different views of when the soul attaches to the body? I mean, to put some meat on the bones, just the question of abortion, for example, would obviously come up with this debate, because if a soul attaches to a body at conception, then it would be mortally wrong to abort a pregnancy, barring an ethical dilemma.
Right.
So what are the different views? You mentioned you believe it is attached at conception. So
right. Well, I wouldn't use the word attach. I would say that it's the very thing that drives it. So the very reason I have, for example, if I were to put a blanket over an object, the reason I know what kind of object it is, even if I can't see it, is because of the form that the blanket takes. So that's what my body is to my soul. So it actually gives evidence to what kind of thing that I am. So at conception, I'd say that that's the very thing that drives it from the beginning. So other views would be maybe, at least for not there being a soul, would be that a person is determined by their function. But if that's true, which it seems, I don't know if he believes that or not, but if that's true, then that means a person doesn't become a person up until a certain age. And then after that age, they start degressing in personhood. But like I said earlier, if personhood is not a degree thing, then that view can't be true. And the only thing that could ground universal value independent of how I function is the fact that I have a soul.
Okay. 30 seconds.
I don't actually know that there's any thing to rebut there, because I don't believe that a soul attaches at all. I'm not necessarily convinced that that it has or couldn't have anything to do with personhood.
Universal value?
Hang on.
It's a simple, I'm not convinced that that's the case. How we tend to define persons...
Let me ask a question then. So
sure.
your minute answer, and then the 30-second response. So he has an argument for when the soul is attached to a human body. What would you say? When would you say that a person comes to possess dignity? I assume we obviously think human beings have dignity.
So the respect for individuals, I think, is something that we imbue people with. I mean, I don't have to respect Eric, but I like him. I don't know him very well, and we've battled, but I like him, and I respect him, and I like the fact that, you know, he knew a lot of things about things. I respect everybody. If you're asking when in the womb does it occur, now I've already done debates on abortion, and it's a whole separate issue where I don't rely on personhood at all. I don't think personhood's relevant to it because it's a matter of bodily rights.
Okay.
Well, it seems that if, again, it seems arbitrary and question begging, but let's not go there again. It seems though that you're basically saying that I just respect someone, which kind of dodges the question. You didn't say when they're due respect. I mean, what part of a function, what part of a person, when do they begin having respect, which is what I'm saying. That's why it's relevant to personhood, because no matter what kind of function you have, whether you're old or you're about to die or you're just being born, or no matter what you can or can't do, that is not what grounds your value. Your value is grounded in the fact that you are a kind of person.
30 seconds. Thank you. I have the same question for both of you guys. Eric, to take turns here. Why do we treat a dead body with dignity?
I think just out of respect for the person that did have that body, in my view, because we believe there's such a deep integration with that body, it's just a symbolic way of honoring that person because that is the body that he had.
Okay. Matt? Why do we treat a dead body with dignity?
Sure, we treat a dead body with dignity and respect. I would say for two reasons. One is out of respect for their family members who have lost somebody. And the other is that by creating the sort of society where people know that we're going to treat dead bodies with dignity and respect, they are more comfortable about what's going to happen to them after they die, irrespective of what they believe or happened to their body.
Okay. I'm just going to ask one more each, and then we'll get into the stack, and I'm going to try to move super fast. Eric, do you believe in a soul of the gaps?
No. I thought you might bring that up. A lot of my arguments weren't, I don't know how this works, therefore a soul. My arguments were, physical stuff can't do this, so you need something non-physical. For example, I could have easily said, Matt's saying there is no soul because of a naturalism of the gaps. We don't know how to investigate it, therefore I can't believe that it's not physical. So the soul of the gaps, which is would essentially be that I'm arguing from ignorance, but I'm not arguing from ignorance. There are some fundamental phenomena about ourselves, unified visual field, identity through time, all these things that need explaining, and which a lot of philosophers and even scientists who are non-believers see that this is a problem. Thomas Nagel wrote an entire book on it. You can't get mind from matter. He actually takes a view that's not really considered a naturalistic view. You have lots of other people who are not even atheists or Christians saying this is a sincere problem. You can't explain this naturally.
Time.
It's strange that you said you could have accused me of believing...
naturalism of the gaps.
Yeah, which is exactly what you said when you said that you think that I refuse to believe because of a prior commitment to naturalism. Which is absolutely false, because not only was I not a naturalist, I was a fundamentalist Christian for more than 25 years, but I had no commitment to naturalism. I became convinced of it. And by the way, I'm only supporting methodological naturalism and not philosophical naturalism. I have never defended that, because that's an assertion that I don't think you can actually make a case for. So,
okay, I'm going to move into y'all's questions. And again, same rules. I'm going to try to go fast. Matt, it's your turn. And I'm not... I haven't had time to proof these very much, so if I say something I shouldn't, forgive me. There's very solid evidence in the field of neuroscience. What are your thoughts on the explanation of a soul in regards to the physiological firing of neurons via action potentials?
One more time?
What are your thoughts on the explanation of a soul in regards to the physiological firing of neurons via action potentials?
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
So the thing is that when you say there's evidence and how do you view it as an explanation for the soul, there's lots of things that we'll find scientific evidence for, and people will say, ah, this is evidence for the soul, like the supposed God module in the brain, things like that. I don't know how they made the connection. I see no demonstration of a connection beyond, hey, this is consistent with what some people said. I don't know what method you could use. As soon as somebody comes up with a method, I'm happy to accept it.
Okay.
Which is where we fundamentally disagree. He thinks that you need a method for everything, but there's a lot of things science can't prove, but it has to presuppose. For example, just a few. Science can't prove the existence of truth. If I try to prove truth exists, I'm already assuming that there is a true or false answer. Science can't prove the existence of the external world. Science can't prove that we can actually know the external world and that the world is going to be the same as it was yesterday. However, science assumes these things. That's why we send people into outer space, because we assume that the world's not going to change, that we have access to the external world, and that we could actually have literal truth. But Matt is saying, well, we don't know, we can't have. Well, then he wouldn't, if that was consistent, he couldn't really live his life that way, and science couldn't even be possible.
Okay. Two questions here. First, if the soul is immaterial to Eric, how does it interact with the material body? And second question, why are the church pews so uncomfortable?
These up here have cushions. You should have sat closer.
I'll answer the second question first, because your soul is what unifies that experience, and if you had no soul, you couldn't experience it. So the first question, it's the problem of interaction, which I thought Matt might have brought up, but I'm glad you brought it up. First of all, you have to understand there are things that are called ontologically basic and ontologically basic actions. Let me explain that. There are some actions that you can explain, like when I turn on my car, why does it turn on? Well, I can explain by it X, Y, Z, and so forth. But there comes a point to where something for a theory is ontologically basic, meaning there is no further mechanism that is an intervening mechanism. Otherwise, like I said earlier, you would keep going back. An example, if you ask me what does it mean to be even, I say it could be divisible by 2. And you say, well, what does that mean? Well, at one point, we have to stop and not ask why is it even, but what does it mean to be even? So the question would be, what does it mean for the soul to interact with the body? And the answer would be, it's a basic action, and you can't assume that there is an intermediate link, because that would lead to an infinite regress. So if there is a soul, it's an ontological basic action.
The benches aren't uncomfortable. They make you uncomfortable. You don't need a soul for that. All you need is a brain attached to nerve endings and gravity that pulls your weight down.
Question, you know, begging?
What's that?
I said just question begging. The thing that we've been saying.
I can't answer the other question of what attaches the soul to the body, because I don't think it does, and I don't know how you could confirm that. So.
Okay.
So I went with the seats.
Hey, you know, some of y'all got here so early. You've been sitting those things so long. So thanks for coming early. I think this is a tough one, Matt. You stated philosophy can prove anything. If that's the case, why isn't it logical to accuse you of engaging in sophistry or believing in any of your philosophical arguments tonight?
Can or can't? Oh, when I said that philosophy can prove anything. Okay, so I'm being a bit hyperbolic here in the sense that a lot of times what philosophers do is great and important. It's the foundation of the philosophy, the philosophies behind science, where we come to understand about falsification and how important it is, philosophy of science from people like Karl Popper. There are other endeavors in philosophy which treat mysteries on the assumption that they can be solved, with no demonstration that this is the case. And so there are, I think, and I'm an idiot, so you can feel free to dismiss it, philosophical constructs whose only purpose they serve is to undergird the proposed solutions to mysteries. They may in fact be correct, but they have no foundation, no demonstration of anything in reality or interacting with reality or in some other reality that's interacting with this reality to show that they're correct. And so they're not really building a model of reality. They're speculating, and in the absence of a scientific answer, they're happy to go with the one they came up with, which I get. I understand that. I just don't see that it's valid.
This is essentially it's a good question because it's asking about, again, our foundations are so different. He takes what is called, or at least it seems like, a scientism approach, which is a view that science is the best way to answer anything. But the irony is that to say that science is the best way to answer something is not a scientific thing, that's a philosophical thing. It's not a scientific statement, it's a philosophical statement about the nature of science. So to even say that science is the best way, or to say that that we don't need philosophy in these areas, is a philosophical statement about not needing philosophy. So again, our very foundations are so different that on his view you can't know anything. On my view, I think you can.
Clearly two different worldviews operating tonight. Eric, a lot of questions, at least several, about animals and souls. It did come up, but let me put it this way. If the brain needs a soul to make the hand move the staff, to move the rock, then does a dog's brain need a soul to chase the cat?
Yes.
If so, how does an animal like a dog or cat ensure that its soul goes to heaven? Is that a Disney reference?
Well, as far as animal souls in afterlife, there's different views on that. I'm not quite sure which one I take. I know J.P. Moreland thinks they don't
go to heaven.
He was one of my favorite philosophers, and I spoke with about a month ago, and yes, I'm name-dropping. But as far as the afterlife has nothing to do with whether or not something has a soul right now, that's a completely different question. And like I said earlier, the two criteria for knowing if something has a soul is, one, does it show evidence of consciousness? Dogs do. Two, is the parts of the dog, do they have their identity before they're part of the dog? Is the parts of that dog still retain their identity when taken off? This table leg will still be a table leg even if I take it off. A dog's heart, when removed from a dog, will cease to function. So its identity gets it from the whole and the relation that it plays in the parts, versus a table leg has its identity independent of the whole. And those are two of the main criteria we use for determining something like that.
So a table leg may or may not be a table leg after you remove it. It's probably more accurate to say it used to be a table leg, and now it's a stick. And it was always a stick, but it was a stick being used as a table leg. This is the problem with putting labels on things. I could take the table leg and carve a baseball bat out of it, and now it's a baseball bat. But if it retains its intrinsic identity as a table leg, well, that couldn't happen. So there are things you can do to change it, to change how we identify it and label it. And on the scientism front, I didn't say that science is the best way to answer anything. My position is science is demonstrably the best way to answer anything that can be answered. I don't know what can or can't be answered, but philosophy is trying to answer the things that science can't, and it doesn't have a mechanism to show that it got it right.
Matt, if energy is not created or destroyed, and our energy transfers into other types of energy when we die, then can our energy be considered a soul?
I don't know why you would. This is something we get from time to time, and I suspect that Eric would disagree just because he thinks there's an actual soul, but this idea that you could argue that energy should count as a soul, I think in that case you've now got a concept where you're desperately looking for anything that will fit it. So I don't want to get rid of the idea of the soul, so can I say that the energy in my brain that dissipates when I die is a soul? Sure, you can say that, but it doesn't have the same connotation. There were a number of cases tonight where I think there were problems of equivocation on identity, on self, on a number of things, and I hope to go back and review it and point something out. You could call that energy a soul, but you could also call this microphone God. This is my God, I worship the microphone. It doesn't have the characteristics that would allow you to have a conversation about whether or not God exists, because clearly the microphone exists. And we're talking about two different things. We're putting the same label on two different things. I don't think it's of much use to try to do that.
30 seconds.
Right, and again, we just come from very different, our foundations are very different. See, I take a view that there are things, at least substances, and that's why you could take a table leg and carve it into a bat, because it's not a substance, it's a mereological aggregate. It's a collection of parts, and that's exactly my point. However, as far as the what you're talking about, the energy and whatnot, there are different forms of dualism, and yeah, I would agree it's not energy because the soul is non-physical. But again, we differ completely because, on my view, substances have essential properties, like the number two can't lose being even, so there are some things that can't be lost and remain the same.
The number two is a substance?
No, I'm saying there are essential properties to things.
Okay.
A number of questions, Eric, in this vein. And by the way, Eric got a lot more questions than Matt, so I'm not going to...
Yeah, thanks, guys. I got a dollar.
So, well, you have a big crowd here, so... Eric, how would you explain, or no, how would the idea of a soul account for multiple personality disorders? Are they the same person or different? Or do they have multiple souls? Likewise, related question, in 1962, Russian physicist Lev Landau was in an auto accident which damaged his brain and altered his personality and destroyed his ability to do physics. Was his soul damaged?
Right, and which is actually what I already went over earlier when I talked about, and I gave the analogy, yes, it's an analogy that you pop a guitar string and you lose functioning. You untune a guitar and you get different kind of music, because if you mess with the physical, then yeah, you affect the ability of the soul to be able to interact. So these kind of cases are essentially cases where you are messing with the thing that the soul uses, much like a musician would not be able to play, even if he's the best musician in the world, with an untuned or badly tuned or pop string guitar. So the inner interaction with the soul and body is such a deep unity that, yeah, if you mess with one, you could affect the other. But like I already argued, the soul also has power over the body. We see that in free will. We see that in neuroplasticity. I can literally, and this is a big deal, you can change your brain chemistry and neuron direction by simply thinking differently. So, I mean, all these things can't be explained. It's not that science can't yet explain it. It's that science is literally incompetent to explain these things.
So this view that the physical prevents the soul from working is something I addressed early on, which demonstrates that the soul isn't needed for the brain to actually do work and do all the things that we identify with it. It's actually kind of weird to me that you could have this idea that there's a soul sitting out there frustrated that it can't do the things that it wants to do because the body is doing the things that it wants to do or is destined to do, whatever. Not only multiple personality disorders, I hope there's a question. If not, maybe we can talk about it later. I'm interested in your take on demonic possession. Or claims of demonic possession, I suppose I should say.
Well, that isn't in the stack here.
It's not in the stack.
It might be.
Debate two.
Let me ask a question about near-death experiences. And
sure.
I'd be interested. In fact, I'm hoping to do a debate on the radio show. I don't think I'm going to be able to do it in person, on demonic possession as a psychological or a spiritual phenomenon. Shameless plug. But I did have questions about near-death experiences. Mm-hmm. And I only bring it up, I know Eric didn't use it in his arguments, but, you know, Gary Habermas does use NDEs quite a bit in part of his resurrection, narrative, I guess, or proof. So how do you explain some of the better, in realizing there are some better near-death experience claims than others?
Yeah, so like I said up there, we keep getting the, how do you explain this if not for that? The answer may be that we don't. But the thing is, near-death experiences have been tested and investigated pretty thoroughly. One thing to remember is they're near-death experiences and not death, although there are people who claim to have gone to heaven and come back or had past lives. And the thing is, none of those things are consistent. So Eric has a number of views about what the soul can and can't do. Reincarnation isn't within his model, so past lives are out. And yet the evidence for the past life stuff is on a par with the NDE stuff. The nice thing is that we've been able to test it, like in environments where you're undergoing a surgical procedure, because you can put a note, for example, on the top of a surface that nobody down below could see. You could put a monkey with a banana, you know, up there that had a T-shirt, you know, of a certain type. If people who claim to have near-death experiences, if you ask them what they saw, nobody's been able to identify any of those things. Nobody's remembered any of those. And what they do claim to remember are things that we would expect from a dying brain that is still receiving input but is in a damaged state. And I'm constantly frustrated by this idea that we should trust a damaged brain more than an undamaged brain about its perceptions of reality, specifically knowing about memory and flawed interpretations.
Well, on Matt's view, if it's your brain that does everything, the more important question would be that if my brain tells me everything, why should I trust my brain at all? Especially if it doesn't have free will and it's determined to believe what it does. It seems, again, we're back to the mechanism, how do you know kind of question, but just asserting that science doesn't have a mechanism, so you can't know, and it could be this or that, is like saying science can't demonstrate that the color blue doesn't have weight, but that doesn't mean it can't have weight. There are simply some things that are metaphysically impossible. As far as near-death experiences, yeah, I believe. I believe they happen.
Sorry, I'm trying to move this. How would you phrase the question on possession, if we wanted to do that?
Oh, I just kind of wanted to know what his take was on claims of demonic possession. That's how I'd phrase it.
And have you ever done an exorcism? No, I'm just
yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
You've done an exorcism?
Yes.
Oh, we definitely have to have a discussion after this.
Okay. Now we know the sequel. Okay, go ahead.
It's definitely metaphysically possible, especially considering that if souls are immaterial, then it's not like you're fitting something in here. And with biblically speaking, demon possession has to do with an oppression, a type of an attack in the spiritual realm. But of course, that would presuppose that there's spiritual realm. I think if something that's non-physical and if there is a soul that can interact, and if all the arguments I said is true, then it is perfectly possible that something like that could happen.
30 seconds.
Not touching out of the 10-foot.
Okay. All right. This, because Eric and I are going to do a podcast, and we're going to review the debate. I'm sure you'll review the debate too, so all's fair and love and debates. And we'll do more comprehensive answers on that. You guys provoked a lot of conversation. Would y'all want to take about a 1 minute just to kind of maybe offer some closing remarks? And before we have a final applause after their closing remarks, there is a reception next door. You can go out that door and come around, or you can go out this door as well. We do encourage you to stay. 1 minute, and you always get the first word, and you always get the last word. So.
Oh, I was willing to give him the last word. It's all good.
It really comes down to a lot of things like our view of truth, our view of knowledge, our view of what can be determined as true. I think you can have truth outside of science, and if you believe that there is no truth outside of science and you're believing something that's not a scientific statement, so it's self-defeating. I gave 7 arguments for the existence of the soul. I said that correlations were not explanations. I said in order to explain this, you need something to ground these things. Matt simply said, well, you could be wrong. That's not a refutation. So in the end, I still think what I said in the beginning is that without any good defeaters, we're still justified in believing that there's a soul based on the metaphysical implications of what it would mean for something, the predictability that we have, and the way that we can explain the things that we do that is literally impossible to be explained by,
30 seconds.
So these things are impossible to be explained scientifically. And again, I want to reiterate, it's not that I'm saying science can't answer the question because we're not advanced yet. I'm saying it's literally like science can't determine whether the color blue has weight because it is metaphysically impossible for the color blue to have weight. These are simply category fallacies. So when you look at the world, not just through a scientific lens, because sure, science is great for discovering natural things, but it has absolutely nothing to say with other things such as metaphysics, essence, question, truth, the external world, and so forth. So, yeah, there's a soul.
So... whether or not the color blue... go ahead.
No.
Whether or not the color blue has weight is a matter of definition, just like there's no married bachelors. It's not a scientific question, it's a question of reason. It's founded on the foundations of reason, identity, non-contradiction, excluded middle, which I take as a presupposition out of practicality. When it comes to a soul, science, and me, doesn't say, oh, there is no soul, or there is nothing supernatural. It just says, we need something more than assertions. We need something more than this seems to fit the experience, or we're going to label this collection of mysteries as the soul. And when we talked about, I think that there were just a number of assertions. Physicalism can't do this. Where's the demonstration of this? Where's the demonstration that physicalism is forever barred from confirming or disconfirming the actions of an immaterial soul that affect a material world? By definition, it manifests in reality in a detectable way. Those are the only things we ever talk about, are things that manifest in reality in a detectable way. Even abstract concepts, number two, It only matters to us in the sense that we use it to identify, to measure, to label things. It's not like two exists somewhere as a thing. And so there's a distinction between concepts, between the physical world, and if in fact there is another realm outside of the physical world where there are thinking agents, where there are substanceless brains, something that's never been demonstrated. Every brain has always, that we've ever witnessed or encountered, has always been attached to, or every mind has always been attached to a brain. Every identification has been of a mind has been attached to a brain. And now there's a supernatural realm where this sort of thing exists, and it's trying to steer your ship, but depending on how well your brain's working, it may or may not be doing a good enough job. Who designs a system like that in the first place? Hey, I'm going to create souls, put them in bodies, or attach them to bodies in a non-physical sense. And sometimes they're not going to be able to do what they're supposed to do.
Can we give both of our speakers a round of applause?